And what Tallinn University did was that it initiated four interdisciplinary clusters. Interdisciplinary is probably the hottest word today.
Yeah, but you may also say that we initiate like cooperation clusters or even knowledge transfer clusters. So it's to build in partnership actually with outside university.
Yeah.
And we don't actually want to call, at least the clusters, we don't want to call them projects, because we rather say that they are kind of a platform for cooperation and also to kind of practice new ways how researchers in the university can cooperate and be more like out of their own box and out of their own field to be interaction with the researchers outside their field. And in addition also that they cooperate with companies, public sector, third sector, people outside the university. So it's kind of, we try to practice new ways of work, I would say.
Yeah, well said. And I'm talking about the MINT cluster, which is called Mind the Metaverse. The version is MINT. And
and I would also say that these are actually rather new initiatives in Tallinn University. We started with the clusters like from 1st of April, from 1st of March this year. So we have had it like half a year or something like that. There was also summer in between. So yes, it's kind of new and
still work in progress of finding out what is the best way of working with each other and so on and so on. But we kind of are really impressed that how good it has turned out so far.
And we also like to be like leaders in certain topic when we want to build collaborations outside the university. So this is also like where we see that we can be the leading party or leading stakeholder in the field. And just maybe important to know, besides me, there are also clusters dealing with STEAM education. Then the third one is dealing with well-being and well-being and workplace, and the fourth one is dealing with different kind of environmental issues of actually tackling with the environmental, mitigating environmental problems. So it's just to give you a more broader picture that with, what are the main topics in which Tallinn University wants to be like, leading the party in the field.
Yeah, and we talk about MINT here because that MINT is the cluster that inevitably involves VR, AR, and the future of the internet. That's why we won't talk about other clusters today. And in our cluster, what we have done is that as we unofficially talked before, that our school ain't that technical school, which means that our strength is more human related, in the sense that we like to look more deeper into how the human computer and human machines and how the humans interact with technology, with different technology. And that is like the overall approach to Metaverse as well from our side. And as the popular word interdisciplinary hints, then we have many different areas of expertise in Tallinn University, and therefore, to make it more understandable, we have divided those expertise in six areas of expertise. And first of them is, of course, media innovation and development research. Indrek Ibrus and Ulrike Aron are the leading roles, in, but also the other people in Medit, but they are more in other areas.
Yeah, as Medit actually is the center of excellence of media and innovation, so it's one of the fields that has spring out of this excellence center.
Yeah, and blockchain and data-driven business models are and Web3 are something that Indrek and Ulrike both are like really into.
And all these kind of changing business models as well, which is part of actually this kind of area.
The second pillar of our cluster is cultural data analytics that Maximilian Schick is leading. What they are doing is AI-based solutions for data archives and big data analytics, and they explore the emergence of media and culture innovations. And they also try to develop services that can be used or replicated in other scenarios as well. So that's also one of the pillars of the MIN cluster. You want to add something?
So everything that is related to data anyhow, and they also develop these new methods and tools and ways how this data can be analyzed, and not only to be used in cultural data, but also in other fields.
Yeah, and what's unique about it is that the data they are dealing with is the so-called the fuzzy data, which means like cultural data. It ain't so well described. It ain't numeric usually. It's words. It's maybe colors. So
or images.
So it's the fuzzy data, and they're trying to make sense out of it. And trying to build tools that can make sense out of it automatically. So and
this actually gives an extra layer if you are analyzing the hard data. If you have some, for instance, population data or this kind of thing, and if you put this cultural data layer on it, you can find some very interesting trends or patterns why people, for instance, are gathering in certain areas in the town or something like that, or where you should establish a cafe or something like that. Probably you may support the integration of different communities because you can actually read the data from that perspective, so it gives you something extra to this hard data and somewhere.
Yeah, it's quite unique, and
it's also quite a new topic in Tallinn University. I think it has been there for
the next pillar is different online practices, digital participation cultures, and social media studies. The key person here is, of course, Katrin Diedenberg, who's...
I'm sorry.
Oh.
This is...
the text is wrong.
Yeah, the text is wrong.
Okay. Some technical issues. But what Katrin is doing is, what the pillar is doing is studying how people use different... social media interaction ways establishing themselves and for example the ways they represent themselves in different environments, and how it connects to Metaverse is that in Metaverse usually we can use either avatars, or if we at one point develop a system that we can be not avatars but real selves, then still we might be not the person we are in real life. So and how the different technologies, what kind of affordances the technology offers, and platforms, and how people use them, how they take advantage of it, or how they miss the opportunity. So this is like.
And this is some definitely a field that is emerging in the future, because there are more opportunities to actually have different representations of themselves.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a very emerging field.
Okay, let's hope that the next one is. This is most natural. It's research in creative and artistic practices and storytelling. And I think it's self-explanatory. So the idea is how to tell stories in the new platforms in new ways, and how we can incorporate storytelling that we are already doing nowadays, but now when we're probably going to have some kind of three-dimensional worlds or the new internet, then how we're going to tell stories there, how we can utilize those tools that will be available, and also how to, for example, how to, that goes also to the Katrin's, the previous pillar is how we can, how people can monetize their creation in the new environments.
And this AI check, how this happening now, that's also kind of related to this theater?
Yeah, in that sense, it was the AI check we started before the classes, but yeah, it definitely fits into that. Who doesn't know, then this Saturday and this Sunday, commercial time, this Saturday, this Sunday, last two performances at Vita Building, here in Tallinn University, Vita Building Black Box Hall. There will be performances of a play that was written entirely by AI. We taught the AI by feeding him with texts of Chekhov, and now we have an artificial intelligence somewhere, who lives in the world of Chekhov, and we call it John, the author. We call it John. John wrote the play. He improvises the music on set. He chooses the visuals. He says what the actors do, where they go, what they say, of course. What else?
Did you choose actors? Like the wall and the
No. He didn't do that. Anyway, really cool thing. Go and check out the webpage, which is also in English perfectly. Is robotitheater.ee.
The whole play is also in English. So
yeah, the whole play is in English, so. Non-Estonian speaking, you don't have any problem with that.
And it's definitely something that you haven't seen in your life. It's so.
Yeah, it's crazy cool.
Yeah.
And the creative body who brought this to life is Liina Keevalik, who's really good art, theater artist. And if you have the availability, then please. Or the robots, actually. Oh, the robots are playing, also. Yeah.
Yeah,
there's no people. Robots are playing. Robots are on the stage.
There are some people on the ground.
it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Okay, back to the slides.
Yeah, I have seen it twice, and I'm going to see it third time as well.
It's different every time, yeah.
It's different.
It's a little bit different.
Yeah, yeah, because there are, and the AI is, well, the whole play is At one point we said that, okay, please write us a really nice play. John did. And in the performance we have segments where we say to John that please improvise, and then he improvises on set. So we don't know exactly what the actors, that means robots, are going to say. So, cool.
Yeah, and it's funny.
Yeah, it's funny as well. Okay, let's move on. Commercial over.
But it was a very good example of creative practice.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely.
And interdisciplinary practice.
Yes. The fifth pillar, as already said, is human-computer interactions. And basically, it's self-explanatory again. How people and computers, how they interact, and mainly on the side of how people feel using all these different technologies, all these new and different spaces, and so on.
And also how different the emotions are related to these interactions, and the development of more empathic, so that AI is actually able to feel the same emotions that can explain and present the same emotions that people can do. So it's in that kind of direction.
Later on, we will. Some of you already who's come to this kind of meetups before already know that. Quite long project that is running here, led by Vietika, is inactive virtual reality avatars, and but we have a separate short video about it, and we will discuss, we'll show it later, and we can get that.
And actually, it has very practical value as well. It's not only that robots with emotions, but we can use this kind of avatars also in socially sensitive situations. So
for example, if you have a small town and there's a police station where only men work, and the girl gets raped, then to get the first testimonies and to get the most accurate information out of her, it would be maybe impossible for a male policeman to do the interrogation or the questioning of interrogation. Questioning, which means that AI, who is socially sensible and can actually feel what the victim is feeling, is more empathetic, and it's easier for the victim to give the testimony. And the sixth pillar is media politics, governance, and cybersecurity research.
And this is kind of related that if we are talking about mediatization of the whole world, so also the governance practices, policy practices, have to encounter it and have to kind of relate it. So this is focusing on finding new governance and policy practices to cope with a new, more media intensive world. And also different kind of participatory practices, so how to involve people, how to build their communities in different ways.
Okay, so that was a really quick overview of the Mint cluster. And as I said, one part of it is research done in university. The other part is collaborating with different governmental, third sector, and public, private sector bodies. And this is something that definitely works in if you think about metaverse style things, because those already involve so many different areas you can't be an expert only in one field, but you have to at least have some idea or grasp the wider picture. The next thing is ES project. That's Pia Tipka's inactive virtual reality lab, and this is about the. I will show the video, and you will get the idea what the project is all about.
The purpose of the research project is to explore the relationship between a human and a human-like character in immersive virtual environments. And I do this by combining methods from arts and sciences. My project particularly emphasizes meanings embedded in the human situatedness, the meaningfulness of the context in which this encounter with artificial humans takes place. If you think to what extent stories penetrate the human society, not only entertainment, but also education, politics, this starts to make sense, right? I think the most complex artificial characters that visually resemble humans are found in video games and films. It's remarkable how human-like these characters have become in their appearance. The algorithmically automatic behaviors have been designed by people. However, they look like humans and smile like humans. To what extent these characters can adapt to the individual player's personality and situatedness in the game story world, for example, or the story outside of the game world, that's relatively limited. There are fields of application for the findings that we have in everyday life. I see my work linked to specific field of social robotics, constructing artificial human agents intended to serve or assist humans in all types of social context. There is a demand for this, one can say. Consider loneliness, for instance. In Europe, loneliness is described as one of the most fatal human conditions that may lead to severe illness and even to death. The question is, could such an adaptive human-like character provide some help for people living in such conditions? Yes, because we know from psychological studies that a friendly human face, just a smiling person in photograph, almost automatically affects the human mind in a positive manner. So imagine having a similar and intelligent, entertaining friend who is familiar with your life, your habits, the names of your children, your hobbies, the tea you like to drink, and in addition to all that, can talk about them. The no comes from the hard challenge of making such characters relevant from the point of view of the context of the lonely person. I'm positive about the outcomes of future research, and I'm really excited to be part of the Estonian scene in studying these artificial characters and their future applications.
To go through it to get to the other side. Yeah. Cool.
Cool, yeah.
Is there anything, we can do a bit of questions, right? Is there any, like, have they tried anything practically with those characters yet? I don't know. If you know, by chance. If not, then that's fine too, but I'm just curious. Maybe Rain has heard something.
I can't remember actually, but what I just remembered what is that we have like different. The play I was talking. Also, coming from Pia's lab, what we did was that we made. Actually, they made a virtual character of. And he looks like a real person, and play, he's reacting live to the noises that are in the hall happening. That kind of experiments, yeah, we've kind of tried, and we did the same for Ulo Bernit, who's the founder of Ulo and the City. We had some kind of event there, and we built an avatar of Ulo Bernit as well. So we've tested, we've tried to make like real persons into avatars that can react to real, like, at the moment happening things. So, yeah. But not facial expressions. The things that we have tried so far are related to sound, and it reacts to sound, but at least I haven't used the version of who's reading the face and the emotion from there. But I know that they are working on it,
just in some event, but actually it was quite an important event where Tallinn University and Ulam City signed a cooperation agreement, and then the founder of Ulam City was kind of also involved.
The next project we have here in Tallinn University in BFM and made it is ScreenME, and this is a training project for excellence in screen media entrepreneurship, scholarship, and maybe you want to...
Yes, this is truly a European project, and like said before, that it focuses on developing screen media entrepreneurship, and deals with like capacity building, like really dedicates on working out and developing new curriculums, but also upgrading the capacity to researchers and doing research as well.
And also for industry.
And also for industry, so it's like there are three kind of directions. One is the curriculum building, one is the research, and also the cooperation with industry partners. And it's an international project, so there are seven partners from different European countries. We in BFM are leading this project, and and actually what we can get out of this project, or what we actually can offer, is that to build this international network of screen media entrepreneur researchers, so to bring home different kind of new knowledge, and also offer it to our companies, and also to build a net like an international network as well. So it's not only about researchers, but also like doing different kinds of meetups, and truly like cross border network building.
I must admit that I don't know too much about the next project, but this is led by Ibrus again, and this somewhat relates to the Kudan project, which is led by Maximilian Schick. But the next project I will briefly talk about is Public Value of Open Cultural Data, and this. This is, for example, what they at the moment are doing is they are using the database of ERR, Estonian National Broadcasting, and they are trying to make sense out of if who's familiar with how TV stations work, then they have this system, usually it's Provis, called Provis the program, and everything that is screened on your TV is in that system, and in that system you have to write short, like syllabus of it, of what's on, what's going to happen in that program. And in ERR, they at one point had the mandatory, obligatory task that the editor, the producers had to like describe whenever the picture changed. So, for example, if it was a wide shot, then you had to describe that, okay, this is a wide shot, what's happening in that shot. It didn't have to be like real detailed, but like general things like three men playing violins. Then you cut to a close-up, then you you have a, like you have the special markings there, which say that, okay, this is a close-up, and again, you describe that a close-up of a man eating the, I don't know, banana.
But this is after it's been filmed already? Not
yeah,
before?
Yeah,
okay.
Afterwards it's edited, and once it like is ready for airing, then the final version is like scripted.
Okay, and then it's for like sensors to go through, or what's the actual use, practical use of this?
There are like many different usages for it. For
okay.
example, if...
maybe you don't need to go super deep, but just
yeah,
roughly, yeah.
If you want to use some kind of take again, let's say, for example, that I'm making a documentary about, I don't know, Denise Maggie, then I can look up from the system what kind of material ERR already has about Denise Maggie,
okay.
So I can reuse some material of it, or to illustrate something.
Got it.
So on, so
video
on.
Search, yeah, that's super useful.
Yeah.
Okay. Exploitation.
Yeah, but it's way more detailed in that sense. But
yeah.
But yeah, basically, yes.
Cool.
Yeah. And what this project is doing is making use of that data and trying to like get new knowledge out of this data that is already there. And unfortunately, ERR is the only one who has that detailed data, but they've also used, I know that they've used Canal Gux channels 2 some data, but the data is like really stripped and really like shallow, so nothing good or nothing remarkable didn't come out of that. And why they are doing this is that this is exactly to it's related to semantic web and what possible usages can be for semantic web and how to teach the AI maybe to read the web in future.
Like
to
blockchain.
Yeah. But I encourage you to please visit this website because, as I said, I'm not an expert in this project.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just trying to...
But this is also Max, yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
So...
Ooh.
And with this,
let's make better humans.
Yeah, let's make better humans. And contact for cooperation, or if you want to transfer any funds to me, then email me.
You will send me better humans back.
I think we are going to
split. Yeah. So, thank you. If you have any questions, then.
So, try. Several times to reach out to Maria, through Maria and Max to get in touch with Tallinn University because I'm running kind of this XR for Ed program myself in Tartu University. But Max always seems so kind of stressed out and worked up that somehow it kind of fizzles always away. So I mean, we all want to be interdisciplinary, but we often don't even manage in our own circles to do it. But maybe it would be nice if you could help me building these contacts again. Also with Maria, I have made. But are you working with the digital transformation group here too in Tallinn University?
Not directly, but
they are kind of part of it as well.
Yeah.
Different activities. So.
Maybe I will try through you again. We can do something together.
Yeah, it's rather approachable.
Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, of course. Shoot me an email and can take it from there.
Mm-hmm.
So, when you mentioned the interdisciplinary collaboration that you are doing in your research, do you also involve psychologists, like psychology research? Because some of the subject that you mentioned, with like measuring emotions and human computer interactions, they really seem like something in the area of empirical psychology.
Yeah, in certain ways, yes, but I think that this cooperation can be stronger. But yes, we have links to the psychologists as well, because the emotions are involved, so you have to explain them somehow.
The reason why I'm mentioning
it. If you see, I know your background.
Yeah, exactly, because my background is both in psychology and media. And some of the stuff that just seems way more closer to psychology than media studies.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how this digital technologies, when they actually measure different kinds of emotions and all these kind of things.
I don't know if they use psychology, but what they mainly do is measure the physiological measurement and how the body usually reacts. But occasionally the research, the experiments, for example, involve psychologists as well. Yeah, so there is that, and as Külliki said, it always could be stronger. I mean, mm-hmm. if you like pinpoint any subject, you can usually always say that it could be stronger. So, but no, but.
Did B actually have background in psychology as well? Or am I misremembering it?
I know that she has film education, but I don't know. Maybe she's worked with psychologists before, maybe. I don't know.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Any other questions?
How much are you kind of having an impact on kind of edtech in some way? So how much do your activities influence new class design? And because you're doing kind of video production. So I was visiting KTU in Kaunas, and they had a media technology program which is similar to the new curriculum that I'm designing in Tartu at the moment for computer graphics and game design. But they had an offspring which was a media lab, and they were big enough that they were influencing the way that they were transforming their classes into kind of flipped classrooms and online classes. So I think if you have an interdisciplinary setup for people who are good in developing media, that could be a connection. But I'm wondering how much are you impacting the future of education with your work?
I think that if we talk about like in really large scale and talk about the whole Estonia, then probably Tallinn University and teaching is like most famous. So Tallinn University is famous because of most of the teachers come out of here. And the second is we are the only film school in Estonia and in Baltic, which means that definitely we do have an impact in that sense. And especially in the last year or two, or maybe even more, it depends on people. And at the moment, we have a really strong researcher in the Janika, who's in like really into edtech, and she is like running multiple projects that try to bring the high schools and previous levels to university into using different media solutions to be used.
And different classroom settings and bringing in more like this, not AI possibilities, but still like robots into the classroom in one way or another.
Yeah.
And and also this there's a cluster initiative that is related to the scheme for education is also including developing different tools, methods, environments, how to build more contemporary classrooms and things.
Yeah, and how to incorporate also like VR photo class into the classes and so on and so on. So.
And they have, especially last sort of 2 years or something, there have been very close connections with the current or the Estonian EdTech community, with the Startup Estonia and all these kind of small companies. So, yeah, different kind of.
I was working with EdTech in Tartu, and they are doing some interesting stuff with doing role plays and using all this facial expression and actually remapping them to hide actually the identity of some of the players to basically allow you to play with your friend but not see him as your friend. And I thought that there were some huge parallels I saw. So you should definitely, I think, play with that device in front of you, with kind of in regarding face gestures.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we should try to get that work today still, to see your own face, facial expressions mapped on a different character.
All right, last question.
I mean, yeah, on one slide, you kind of put all the buzzwords. Like AI and VR and metaverse and you know and also was it data driven approach and big data etc. But and one buzzword was also mentioned was crypto coins or
blockchain.
So yeah, basically my question related to this is that do you also or in which projects do you use those cryptocurrencies, tokens, or are you using it in any projects, or have you, do you have any projects which relate to that?
Cryptocurrency projects,
you can also say like tokens or.
Yeah, I know that Indrek has played around a bit with those, but. Commenting on your comment that we put all the buzzwords on the screen. Well, first, yes, why not? Second is that, as we said, this cluster is quite new, and these are the areas that we desire to work on. That doesn't mean that we, each and every one of them, we have a project and we have like researchers doing that for 3 years already,
but
and so on and so on.
But you more or less covered all the passwords.
Yeah. It's good for a search engine. and what we have done with cryptocurrencies, for example, is that we do research them. We have the Screen Media and Innovation, the master's program I talked about. There are two projects that quite deeply research the scams in cryptocurrencies. So that means that there are coming experts out of Tallinn University who know how crypto scams work, and they've gone really deep into it. So yeah, we are doing some kind of research in that sense, yes. But we are not. We want to. we can do that kind of business as well. If you.
I suppose there's like pros and cons with some of the buzzwords. For example, that with Metaverse, there's a lot of interest in some regard, but at the same time, about a month ago at the last Meta Connect, when Mark Zuckerberg announced their continued research and investments into the Metaverse, and at the same time with a huge decline of the Meta stock, I think in the last weeks I've seen dozens of articles like how how stupid the whole thing is, and you know, you can get like positive attention but also negative attention attached to these buzzwords.
I couldn't agree with you more. Just yesterday we had a really
well, the stock declined because of ad revenue declining, so just to be clear. But yes, obviously. Sorry.
Yesterday we had a really heated debate with the professors exactly on that topic, that some of them said that Metaverse has a negative connotation, and some of them said that, yeah, it does, but our aim here is to explain. Accidentally, it was bad timing for us, because we had the Metaverse project. it was a project, and then we developed it into a cluster. We had it ready like 9 months before, and when we kind of decided that, okay, let's go with that, then I think it was week after, then Facebook announced that, oh yeah, we're building a Metaverse, and we're changing our name to Meta. So what we're trying to do is that to explain as much as we can that Metaverse doesn't equal Facebook. By no means. Metaverse is way, way, way larger and the wider thing, and Facebook is just trying to steal that name or the word.
Did you read Snow Crash?
Sorry?
Did you both read Snow Crash?
Yeah.
It's kind of the question I usually run around and see how many people actually read the book from Neil Stevenson. But
yeah. Long ago, right?
And of course, watched several times Ready Player One.
I read Ready Player Two.
So yeah.
Me too. But anyway.
You're Animal, yeah?
Animal.
Yeah. Okay. I wasn't sure if I. Is this a contracted name or the full name?
Cool. So let's milk this Metaverse term as much as we can before it becomes unpopular.
I think it's good for all of us if we spread the word, and if someone says that Metaverse equals Facebook, then we punch them, and once they come unconscious again, then we explain like slowly that this is not Facebook, this is not Facebook, this is not Zuckerberg.
But I think we can also say not everything that of this investment will turn out to be evil, so I think there's also
are good sides of it as well, but yeah. As the Facebook reputation is what it is at the moment, yeah. And it's an old people platform to be, so it's kind of, but
it's also not only about Facebook, it's also the way that the term is being used by a lot of other companies, yeah. As well, mostly in the US probably, but like a lot of big companies like Microsoft or Disney, they have like a chief Metaverse officer and whatnot, and it's kind of like,
yeah.
when you have been living and working in this field for a longer time, you know that, you know, it has been grown for a long time, and then somebody comes in, puts a label on top of it and says, you know, this is our thing, then you know, there's a lot of negative connotations. Not only because of Facebook and what they're doing, but also it's like some business oriented or
the sharks,
yeah,
come around,
sharks
smell money,
trying to make the buzzwords. But that's basically the case with every buzzword.
Mm.
With every buzzword, there's probably some people behind it who actually have integrity and have been building it for years, and then somebody comes in, tries to make a quick buck and somehow right away.
Yeah, Mark, you were kind enough and participated the Agonbus Festival.
Yes.
And maybe you remember that we also discussed the naming of the discussion as well, that we wanted to avoid the Metaverse trap exactly on those reasons. And that's why when we speak about it, if you want to say it like shortly, then we say Metaverse, but we kind of try to broaden the term that the new internet or the spatial internet or
yeah.
Trying to already
spatial internet, I think, is the easiest way.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Continue at the break.